Hello learners, today we'll be talking about Coleridge's Biographia Literaria. We shall begin this session with an introduction to the Biographia by looking at its genesis and reception. Thereafter, we'll be discussing at least two aspects that are outlined in the Biographia, namely A. Coleridge's definition of nature and the self, and B. his definition of fancy, primary imagination, and secondary imagination. Biographia Literaria, or Biographical Sketches of My Literary Life and Opinions, was written in 1815 in the form of a meditative narrative and first published in 1817 in two volumes of 23 chapters. 30 years after its initial publication, a second edition was published by Coleridge's wife Sarah in 1847, that is 13 years after the death of Coleridge. The standard edition is edited by James Engle and W. Jackson Bate, which is volume 7 of the collected works published by Princeton University Press, 1983. According to Coleridge, he began writing the Biographia with the intent of publishing it as a preface to the collection of poems he was composing in 1815, a collection which was eventually published as Sibylline Leaves in 1817. Now, despite Coleridge's original intention, Biographia in due course expanded into a fusion of autobiography, where he talks about his life, education, and early literary adventures. Literary criticism, particularly an extended criticism of Wordsworth's theory of poetry, practical criticism, literary, philosophical, as well as religious theory. Now, given the nature of such shifting objectives, Coleridge himself describes the Biographia as an immethodical miscellany of life and opinions in the fourth chapter. Insofar as the critical response to the Biographia is concerned, we may recall that in his introduction to an abridged edition of 1906, the poet Arthur Symons describes the work as the greatest book of criticism in English and one of the most annoying books in any language. Whereas J.A. Appleyard in Coleridge's Philosophy of Literature, 1965, calls it an unplanned masterpiece, which he views as unread and largely unreadable. In Revolution and Romanticism, 1974, Howard Mumford Jones famously interprets the Biographia as a text with a hodgepodge makeup and one that is anarchical in structure. Thus, these comments by critics and Coleridge's own summation of his work as an immethodical miscellany point to an overall lack of aesthetic unity and provide the general tenor surrounding the reception of the Biographia. Now, an interesting fact about the Biographia is that it was composed at a time when Coleridge's health was declining between April and September 1815. Now, during this period, he was prone to bouts of suicidal depression induced, as it were, by his addiction to opium. So we see that the composition of the Biographia began as a type of literary convalescence, as Coleridge dictated much of it to his friend John Morgan. It is not surprising, therefore, that the overall topography of the Biographia tends to be digressive and perhaps even amounts to a patchwork of sorts. It is for this reason that J. Shawcross, 1907, attributes the miscellaneous character of the book to the poor state of Coleridge's health and spirits. It is also not surprising then that central to the narrative is a concern about the reconciliation between the head and the heart. And such a concern with the reconciliation of opposites in general leads to Coleridge's theory of imagination, and in particular towards his concept of the secondary imagination. Now, his theory of imagination, the crux of which is contained in chapters 13 and 14, was inspired by three sources. A. William Wordsworth's theory of imagination. B. German and transcendentalist thinkers like Immanuel Kant and Friedrich Schelling. C. David Hartley and the Associationist School of Psychology. Now, my dear learners, you will recall that we have already spoken about A, B, and C in great detail in some of our previous sessions. Now, I would suggest that when you read the biographia, then do read it by paying special attention to chapters from 12 to 15, and in particular to chapters 13 and 14, which contain Coleridge's theory of imagination. However, before we explain his theory of imagination, it is imperative for us to understand Coleridge's attempt to define nature and self, an attempt that precedes his statement of the theory of imagination. Now, how does Coleridge define the relationship between nature and the self? Coleridge says that nature, the sum of all that is objective, is passive and unconscious, while the self or intelligence, the sum of all that is objective, is vital and conscious. All knowledge is the product of the commingling of object and subject, of nature and the self. This commingling, coupling or unification of object-subject leads to the act of creation, which for Coleridge is signified in the phrase, I am. It is in this state of self-consciousness that object and subject, being and knowledge, are identical, and the reality of the one life in us and abroad is experienced and affirmed, and chaos is converted into a cosmos. Now, how is this chaos converted into a cosmos? During this state of self-consciousness, the self or the spirit views itself in all objects, which as objects are dead and finite. Coleridge's theory of creative imagination, which we will be talking about next, essentially stems from this conceptual framework. Coleridge builds his theory of imagination on the basic distinction between fancy and imagination. He first refers to this significant distinction in chapter 4 of the Biographia. Coleridge says, and I quote, "Repeated meditations led me first to suspect, and a more intimate analysis of human faculties, their appropriate marks, functions and effects matured my conjecture into full conviction that fancy and imagination were two distinct and widely different faculties, instead of being, according to the general belief, either two names with one meaning, or at furthest the lower and higher degree of one and the same power," unquote. Now, what is fancy? The word is from the Middle English fancy, spelt as F-A-N-T-S-Y, meaning imagination or mental image, which is ultimately from the Greek phantasy, spelt as P-H-A-N-T-A-Z-E-I-N, meaning to make visible or present to the mind. Now, during the 17th century, the terms imagination and fancy were virtually synonymous and often used interchangeably. The 18th century accorded a superior status initially to one term and later to the other. But finally, by the end of the century, imagination came to be firmly established as the superior term when Coleridge stated his theory of distinction between the two terms, a theory that has had a lasting influence. Now, what is the difference between fancy and imagination? Coleridge says, and I quote, "Fancy has no other counters to play with but fixities and definites. The fancy is indeed no other than a mode of memory emancipated from the order of time and space, while it is blended with and modified by that empirical phenomenon of the will, which we express by the word choice. But equally with the ordinary memory, the fancy must receive all its materials ready-made from the law of association," unquote. The difference between imagination and fancy, as we shall see soon, is one of kind rather than of degree. Between fancy and imagination, Coleridge considers fancy to be the inferior of the two. Fancy is essentially mechanical, aggregative. It receives all its raw material through the law of association. Fancy is a kind of memory. It arbitrarily brings together elements, assembles and joins them without blending. And even when brought together, these elements continue to retain their separate and individual properties. They receive no coloring or modification from the mind, and so fancy has no transformative power, no creative power at all. Fancy only combines what it perceives into pleasing shapes. Unlike the imagination, fancy neither fuses nor unifies. Fancy is employed for tasks which in Coleridge's words are passive and mechanical. It works on pre-existing sensations and fabricates without refashioning or altering the parts that are merely reassembled into a different spatial and temporal order from which they were originally perceived. In short, for Coleridge, the difference between imagination and fancy then is the same as the difference between a mechanical mixture and a chemical compound. In a mechanical mixture, a number of ingredients are mixed together, yet they do not lose their individual properties. In a chemical compound, the different ingredients combine to form something new. The different ingredients no longer exist as separate entities. They lose their respective properties and individual identity and fuse together to create something new and entirely different. In this sense, the composition of a chemical compound is an act of creation and therefore analogous with imagination, while the composition of a mixture is merely a placement of a number of separate elements together and hence analogous with fancy. Another very, very simple example of fancy here is of a notice board. Now, you can pin a number of circulars, notices or drawings onto a notice board that is installed on the wall, say right outside the principal's office at your college. Now, even if you remove a few of these clippings or add a few others, it doesn't change the essential quality of the notice board, which is to provide information. It also doesn't change the individual properties of each of these clippings. What continues to happen is addition and subtraction, rearrangement and recombination on a daily basis without leading to any transformation or to the creation of anything new. Further, Coleridge describes fancy as the faculty of bringing together images dissimilar in the main by some one point or more of likeness. Coleridge substantiates his view on the difference between fancy and imagination by citing two passages from Shakespeare's Venus and Adonis. As an example of fancy, he quotes, "Full gently now she takes him by the hand, a lily prisoned in a goal of snow, on ivory in an alabaster band, so white a friend engirth, so white a foe." Coleridge points out that in these lines, the images do not interpenetrate into one another. Citing the following lines to depict the working of the imagination. "Look how a bright star shooteth from the sky, so glides he in the night from Venus's eye." Coleridge remarks, "How many images and feelings are here brought together without effort?" Coleridge remarks, and I quote, "How many images and feelings are here brought together without effort and without discord? The beauty of Adonis, the rapidity of the flight, the yearning yet helplessness of the enamored gazer, and a shadowy ideal character thrown over the whole," unquote. Fancy for Coleridge is thus the drapery of poetic genius, but imagination is its very soul, which fuses to transform everything into one concrete, cohesive, intelligent, and graceful whole. Now, this is so far as fancy is concerned. Now, what is imagination? Chapter 13 of the Biographia begins with the phrase "own the imagination" or "esemplastic power." The Oxford Dictionary defines the adjective "esemplastic" as molding into one or unifying. Coleridge himself introduces his neologism "esemplastic" at the beginning of chapter 10, which he describes as follows. And I quote, "Esemplastic, the word is not in Johnson, nor have I met with it elsewhere. Neither have I constructed it myself from the Greek words I in platen, that is to shape into one." In their note to Coleridge's explanation, Engel and Bate gave this account. And I quote, "Coleridge's term esemplastic can be traced direct to his front flyleaf note in Mass. Mass being Johann Mass's experiment on the imagination 1792, second edition 1797. Coleridge is discussing Mass's definition of form as something ab intra and wondering whether the imagination as a faculty of perception does not exercise a formative and external active power as it experiences the world," unquote. For Coleridge, a simplistic power or the imagination is a unifying and intuitive power, where the tendency of reason is to analyze, examine, and reduce the sum of everything into parts. Imagination functions in an exactly reverse manner by blending all the individual parts together into an organic whole, thereby leading us to perceive the oneness of the universe. Now, Coleridge subdivides imagination into primary and secondary imagination. Now, what does he mean by primary imagination and what does he mean by secondary imagination? Coleridge says, and I quote, "The imagination then I consider either as primary or secondary. The primary imagination I hold to be the living power and prime agent of all human perception, and as a repetition in the finite mind of the eternal act of creation and the infinite I am. The secondary I consider as an echo of the former, coexisting with the conscious will, yet still as identical with the primary in the kind of its agency and differing only in degree and in the mode of its operation. It dissolves, diffuses, dissipates in order to recreate, or where this process is rendered impossible, yet still at all events it struggles to idealize and to unify. It is essentially vital, even as all objects, as objects are essentially fixed and dead." Unquote. Let us now try and list in greater detail the nature and characteristics of the primary imagination as described by Coleridge in the Biographia. Primary imagination comprises the capacity for receiving impressions of the external world through the senses. It is the living power and prime agent, as Coleridge says, and it is universal, that is, possessed by all of us. Thus, primary imagination is the common faculty that is possessed by each one of us. It is the consciousness shared by all human beings. Because it represents the basic agency of human awareness, the primary imagination acts independently of human will. In this sense, the primary imagination is a spontaneous act of the human mind, the image so formed of the external world involuntarily and unconsciously. The primary imagination is therefore our inborn power of perception. For Coleridge, then, it is, as he says, the source of all animate power. Its synthetic power operates through the most direct contact between the human mind and nature. This power enables us to identify, discriminate, divide, separate, synthesize, organize, and produce order from chaos, and thereby to associate a series of objects, ideas, images, or situations, which may or may not necessarily be visual, and form an intelligent view of the creation of God. Coleridge therefore calls the primary imagination as a divine ability to create. And for this reason, primary imagination is also, for Coleridge, the necessary imagination, as it automatically balances and fuses the innate powers and capacities of the human mind with the external presence of the objective world that one receives through the senses. This necessary imagination is a reflex or instinct of the mind, and what Immanuel Kant calls an empirical, as distinct from a transcendental degree of the imagination. Because it unifies by bringing together sensory data into larger units of understanding, the primary imagination encompasses a process that in Coleridge parallels Immanuel Kant's unity of the manifold. Now, a simple example that would make the concept of the primary imagination clear is perhaps the kind of reaction we often have when we see, let's say, a Facebook picture of a friend who's on a vacation in some other city or country. Now, when we see this Facebook picture, our brain starts dwelling on it, and this is what Coleridge means by involuntary perception. And once we begin to dwell upon it, we will begin to imagine a scenario wherein we will also one day go on a vacation, travel to the same city or country, and all these scenarios that we are constructing in our mind, that we are constructing through our imagination, amount to a spontaneous act of the human mind. Okay, so primary imagination is a combination of two things, involuntary perception and spontaneous act, which is signified in this example of a friend which is signified in this example of a Facebook picture of a friend who is vacationing in some other land. Now let's talk about secondary imagination. Coleridge uses the term secondary imagination to refer to the human ability to transcend this primary organization in order to reassemble perceptual elements of fragments and create new meaning. Now, what are some of the characteristics of the secondary imagination? Firstly, the secondary imagination is the creative or poetic imagination. It coexists with the conscious will that is peculiar to artists and involves elements of both conscious as well as subconscious activity. Poetic making blends conscious selection with subconscious infusion, and during this process of blending or making, some elements are consciously chosen while other elements are mysteriously supplied from the depth of the poet's subconscious mind. Secondly, secondary imagination is the magical synthetic power supplied by primary imagination. When Coleridge says that secondary or poetic imagination dissolves, diffuses and dissipates in order to recreate and that it is essentially vital, what he means here is that everything in the world is in a sense dead, and only the poet's imagination can bring aspects of the world alive, an idea that is implied in his use of the word vital. Just as the coalescence of components in a chemical reaction, the secondary imagination also dissolves and reintegrates various components in a new way that draws attention to the fusion of these elements. Thirdly, this willful and poetic imagination differs only in degree from the primary imagination, and Coleridge re-emphasizes the instigation and control of the human will by saying that in the poet, this power is first put in action by the will and understanding. Because of this exercise or exertion of self-will, the secondary imagination limits itself only to a select number of individuals, and unlike the primary imagination, it is not common to all human beings. The poetic or secondary imagination thus becomes the fullest exercise of the self and of its inner powers. It is free will, our only absolute self, that controls and directs the creative activity surrounding the production of art. This gives poetry and all human creation a moral dimension as well as a moral responsibility. The secondary imagination creates new images and symbols, and in the process it reconciles the self-conscious mind with that picture of the universe which has already been formed involuntarily by the primary imagination. In this way, the creation of art blends the self-conscious mind with nature into one seamless product and helps us in understanding the essential oneness within the universe. It bridges the gap between the world of spirit and matter. It fuses the external and the internal, the objective and the subjective. It fuses perception, memory, intellect, passion and feeling into one big whole. It reconciles opposites, synthesizes dialectically opposed forces, and unifies disparate elements. Fourthly, we must remember that for Coleridge, even though the secondary imagination is higher in degree than the primary imagination, yet both the primary and secondary imagination are still of one kind. Secondary imagination is not independent. It must rely on the primary or necessary imagination for its raw materials. The secondary imagination selects and orders the raw material that already exists within the primary imagination and reshapes and remodels it into objects of beauty to create a new reality, a reality whose prime attribute is, of course, organic unity. In this way, the secondary imagination goes beyond the primary imagination despite being dependent on it. Fifthly, the common man equipped with only the primary imagination cannot create, although he may appreciate this complex and richer degree of imaginative vision. This is also part of Coleridge's argument against Wordsworth's exaltation of the language used by the rustics, where Wordsworth says, and I quote, "Humble and rustic life was generally chosen because in that condition the essential passions of the heart find a better soil in which they can attain their maturity. unless under restraint and speak a plainer and more emphatic language," unquote. Now, unlike Wordsworth, for Coleridge, the best part of human language is not a product of the primary imagination, an imagination possessed by the rustics, an imagination that requires no effort, but instead the best part of human language is the result of a voluntary act performed by a mind self-consciously aware of its own imaginative potential. The secondary imagination is one that requires effort. And it is this secondary imagination and not the primary imagination that is the root of all poetic activity and of poetry itself for Coleridge. Finally, Coleridge's description of the secondary imagination as an echo of the former, that is an echo of the primary imagination, coexisting with the conscious will, reminds us of Carl Jung's idea of archetypal power, the capacity to echo and perhaps replicate the original creatio through the generative power of an image. Now, to explain the secondary imagination in very simple words, let's come back to the same example that we had spoken about earlier, that is of seeing a friend's picture on Facebook who is on a vacation in some land that has immense scenic beauty. Now, many of us visit places of scenic beauty, but not all of us can translate that experience into, say, a painting or a poem or some other form of art. It is only the artist who can convey and express these ideas through the medium of art, aided as he is by the secondary imagination. So, learners, now it's time that we sum up what we discussed today. We began with an introduction to the Biographia Literaria by looking at its genesis and reception. Now, following this, we spoke about Coleridge's distinction between fancy and imagination. Thereafter, we spoke about the two subdivisions within imagination, that is, primary imagination and secondary imagination. I also gave you some examples which are given by Coleridge himself, and there were certain very basic everyday examples to explain what he means by fancy, what he means by primary imagination, and what he means by secondary imagination. Now in our next session we would be talking about the meaning of the famous phrase given by Coleridge, which is the willing suspension of disbelief. We will also be talking about Coleridge's views on poem, poet, and poetry as described in the Biographia Literaria. Thank you for listening, my dear learners. I hope you enjoyed this session.